ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Welcome back to another episode of Saviors of Islam. Tonight we look at another female figure that has left a beautiful legacy behind, Fatima bint Abd al-Malik. The poem says, or the poet says beautifully, بنت الخليفة والخليفة جدها أخت الخلائف والخليفة زوجها. Fatima bint Abd al-Malik was the daughter of a caliph. Her husband was a khalifa, a caliph. Her grandfather, father, and brothers were khulafa. So she grew up in a house of privilege. She was pampered. Poems were written about the level of luxury that she grew up in. So imagine, from the very beginning, she was treated with all kinds of royalty. Her family invested in her learning the language, learning poetry, learning the Quran, learning the Hadith, and she was set up to be pampered and to live a life of luxury. Her father chose Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz. He was considered the fifth rightly guided Khalifa. We spoke about him. But the father chose Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, and she chose Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz way before he was a Khalifa, when he was, you know, making his way up the ranks, and he was known at that time for his commitment to the deen, for his love for the Sunnah, for the Quran, for the Hadith, and for his commitment to achieving, that resilience that he had, wanting more, wanting to achieve more and to be motivated to continue to give back. So Fatima bint Abd al-Malik, what we'd like to focus on for tonight is the beautiful episode in her life when she had to make a difficult decision. When her husband became the Khalifa, on the third day, he told her, "You have to make a decision. I want to live." You know, imagine both of them lived a life of luxury, as we mentioned, a life of luxury, unimagined luxury. And finally, when he became the Khalifa, her husband became the Khalifa, he looked at her and he said, "I want you to make a decision." Everybody around us, we see how the world has consumed and has really distracted them. Everybody's become so greedy, so selfish, so focused on money. I don't want to live this life anymore. I want to live a life of humility. You know, so much injustice has been done in the name of power. What I would like to do is I would like to reverse all of the injustice. So she's listening. What do you have in mind? "I want to take all the wealth that we have, and I want to, all of the stuff that we inherited, the gold and the silver and the possessions, all of it, I want to give it back to the treasury, so that it becomes something that is to be owned by the Muslims, so that it helps the poor, it helps those who are struggling, it helps those who are in a tough time." So I want you to imagine, he tells her, "You have a choice. If this is the lifestyle that you want to pursue with me, I'm more than happy to go and continue this relationship, and let's do this together. But if you want to go separate ways and you don't want this life, I completely understand." So he gives her that choice. What does she say? She says, "I'm not going to abandon you in challenging moments like I haven't abandoned you in good moments. As long as you're doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you'll find me to be supportive. You'll find me to be supportive." And what's amazing here, my brothers and my sisters, is this beautiful episode in the life of Fatima bint Abd al-Malik and her husband. It reminds us beautifully of another episode in the Prophet Muhammad's life. And I wanted to really focus on this, the message for tonight, these beautiful ayat from Surah Al-Ahzab. Let's read them together, because these are the ayat that Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz recited to Fatima bint Abd al-Malik to prepare her to make that decision. And what happened after that? What legacy did they leave behind? We'll come back to that after we look at the ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 32, you can, you know, look at the Quran together, look at the translation. This is 33, Surah 33, ayah 32 onwards. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله سبحانه وتعالى says, يا نساء النبي لستن كأحد من النساء إن اتقيتن فلا تخضعن بالقول فيطمع الذي في قلبه مرض وقلن قولا معروفا. Now I want us to go back a few ayat, a few ayat. Listen to this, ayah 28, to contextualize. Ya ayyuha an-nabiy qul li azwajik, O Prophet, say to your wives, in kuntunna turidna al-hayata ad-dunya, If you want this life, if you want this worldly life, إن كنتن تردن الحياة الدنيا وزينتها فتعالين فتعالين أمتعكن وأسرحكن سراحا جميلا. If you want this life and the dunya and everything in it and the beautiful luxuries of the dunya, then let me know. Come, let me know. I will give you a suitable compensation and we can go our separate ways. So imagine, if you want the dunya, I'm okay, I'll give it to you. But I don't want the dunya. That's not what I'm here for. So if that's what you want, go ahead with it. And this ayah is revealed at a time in which Medina was thriving. Wealth was coming. So when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's wife said, Ya Rasulullah, all the other men are building bigger homes and they're moving on to bigger places. What about what's the future looking like? So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave his wives a choice. You can choose to pursue dunya or you can choose to be invested for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's what the second option was in ayah 29. وَإِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِدْنَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. And if you want Allah and His Messenger, وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ, and the eternal home, what should you do? فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَعَدَّ لِلْمُحْسِنَاتِ أَعَدَّ لِلْمُحْسِنَاتِ مِنْكُنَّ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Then know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for those of you who excel a great reward, a great reward. So He's giving them a choice. Dunya, you can go your separate way, or you can choose to excel for the sake of Allah. And know that Allah has prepared an immense reward. Ya nisa'a an-nabi, O wives, O women of the Prophet. What does he say? مَنْ يَأْتِ مِنْكُنَّ بِفَاحِشَةٍ مُبَيِّنَةٍ يُضَاعَفْ لَهَا الْعَذَابُ ضِعْفَيْنِ وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرًا. Whoever amongst you comes with a blatant misconduct, the punishment would be doubled for that individual. وَمَنْ يَقْنُتْ مِنْكُنَّ لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا نُؤْتِهَا أَجْرَهَا مَرَّتَيْنِ وَأَعْتَدْنَا لَهَا رِزْقًا كَرِيمًا. O wives of the Messenger, listen to this. Whoever commits with devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the Messenger of Allah, and does good and excels, Allah will double her reward. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prepare an amazing, honorable provision. Now, why is this important? Why is this? What's the connection here? And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is reminding the women, the wives of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because you are now entrenched in a position of responsibility, because you're very close to the figure of the head of the community, you have to hold yourselves to a higher standard. So when you make a mistake, it's going to receive double the punishment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you do good, you're going to receive double the reward. Why? Why double the punishment? Because whatever you do, it's no longer just about you. You're going to be responsible for influencing and inspiring other people to do the same. And when you do good, it's going to be difficult. It's going to be difficult because you have to struggle against all of the eyes and have to, you know, cope with all of the attention and still do good despite of the difficulties that come with it. So when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz gave his wife Fatima bint Abdul Malik a choice, he recited those ayat, and he recited those ayat in salah to prepare her for it, and she made the decision. Just like Aisha radiallahu anha looked at Rasulullah and she was the first. Rasulullah said, he recited the ayat and he told her, you have a choice. Go back, think about it, discuss with your family, discuss with your father. Aisha radiallahu anha looked at Rasulullah and said, no discussion needed. I choose you. I don't choose dunya. I choose you. Can you imagine? What a beautiful moment. Aisha didn't hesitate, radiallahu anha. Similarly with Fatima bint Abdul Malik, she didn't hesitate. She said, I am with you through thick and thin. Loyalty, commitment, devotion. And she had to change her life. You know, she was used to luxury. Now she had to cook herself, clean herself. No more service, no more servants. No, none of that in the house. She had to sometimes, subhanAllah, work with very limited ingredients in the house. Sometimes there would be nothing. Once her own husband came and he asked her, can I borrow a dirham from you so I can go buy something? I have nothing. So imagine the house had nothing. They gave everything away for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at a time of intense materialism. Why? to make a point clear, to reverse some of that damage, to set a good example, to look in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day with no guilt, knowing I haven't contributed to the problem, I've done the best that I can to resolve it, to resolve it. Absolute disconnection from materialism. Now, I always mention and I preface by saying, we don't have to divorce the dunya. We don't. But there are times where we have to hold ourselves accountable and dissociate our hearts. You know, to have zuhud, asceticism, is not to own nothing, it's to be owned by nothing. It's to be owned by nothing. And I think we're living in a time where materialism has really gripped all of us. We look for attention. You know, the world that we're living in, it's all about the aesthetic, it's all about the optics, all about the outward. And we've really neglected the inward. But Fatima bint Abd al-Malik gave all that materialism. And she realized that living for materialistic pleasure is like trying to grasp water with open fingers. You'll feel the rush, but none of it remains. And she dedicated her life to the service of the community. In those 2 years that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz served as the Khalifa, poverty was gone in the community. They were looking for people to give zakat to. There weren't anybody. There was nobody available. Why? Because the leaders led by example. And when the leaders lead by example, everybody else steps up to the plate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow those amongst us who are in a position of leadership to step up to that plate, to lead by example. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his whole service to the community, he didn't charge a single penny. He made it clear that he's not there to make profit. He's there to deliver a message. He said, لا زكاة لقريشي, according to one hadith, and this question about it. But the more authentic one, there is no money to be given to my family. So even after his death, if you're related to the Prophet Muhammad from Banu Hashim or related members of the community of Rasulullah, you are not allowed and entitled to receive money from zakah or sadaqah. Why? To make it very clear that it was not about building his own socioeconomic status. It was not about building his own reputation. It was not about building and accumulating materialism and accumulating capital. None of that. It was about serving and giving and sometimes having to go out of your way and sometimes compromise yourself a little to be there for the community. وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. As Allah mentions, the people of Medina, Allah describes them when the Muhajirin came to them, Allah says, they used to be so altruistic that they would have needs, but they would put their own needs secondary to the needs of those that they serve. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among them, Ya Rab, Ameen. Now when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz passed away, Yazid became the Khalifa, and he was the brother. He was the brother Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik, the brother of Fatima ibn Abd al-Malik. So he came to Fatima, his sister, and he said, now that Umar is gone, you can have your money back, you can have the treasures back, you can have all these jewelry, all of it back. Is that what you want? She says, absolutely not. It's not what I want. I've loved living that life with Umar, and I want to be committed to his legacy after he's gone. After he's gone, I want to commit my life to prayer, to standing up, committing myself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, teaching and educating and giving that legacy behind and taking care of the poor people of the community. Taking care of the poor people of the community. So Yazid insisted, and he sent the money anyway. He sent the gold anyway. He sent all of that anyway. So she took it and she donated it to those that were in need. A legacy of selflessness. Someone who experienced luxury, tasted it, but gave it up for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to send a point clear to everybody that we're not there for the money. We're not there to oppress and, you know, take advantage of others and grow at other people's expense. No, we're ready to make sure that others grow through whatever Allah has given us. And if it means compromising a little bit, we're willing to do that. That's our legacy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us selfless. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us dedicated. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who give continuously in difficult times and good times. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be from those who inspire others through our giving. Jazakumullah khairan for tuning in. See you next time, 8:30 inshallah, around that every night for the next few nights inshallah ta'ala. Saviors of Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.